Former Vice President of AJAZZ and the current Vice President of the Alambre Brath Foundation. I'm going to give you a brief history of AJAZZ and the Grandassa models. In 1956, a group of young artists, photographers, and jazz fans, Alambre Brath, Kwame Brathwaite, Bob Gums, Chris Osman, D.C. Hall, and Cletus Smith formed the Jazz Arts Society, later renamed the African Jazz Arts Society and Studios, AJAZZ, in the South Bronx. AJAZZ produced a series of Sunday afternoon jazz concerts at the Club 845, featuring many famous and new jazz musicians and singers. In 1961, Alambre, Kwame, and other members of AJAZZ attended the annual Miss Natural Standard of Beauty contest produced by Carlos A. Cooks and the African Nationalist Pioneer Movement, ANPM, to celebrate the birthday of Marcus Garvey, August 17th. The young ladies in the contest wore no makeup and were required to wash out any chemicals from their hair so that it would be in its natural state. After the contest, Alambre proposed the idea that AJAZZ create a fashion show featuring black models wearing their hair natural. The models were called the Grandassa models. The name Grandassa Land was the name that Carlos Cooks called Africa. On Sunday, January 28, 1962, AJAZZ produced the first fashion show called Naturally 62. The show was held at the Purple Manor in Harlem and featured the Grandassa models, Black Rose, Nomsa Brath, Claire Lewis, Priscilla Bartnelli, Marie Toussaint, and Esther Davenport. The male models were Jimmy Abu Williams, who trained the Grandassa models, and Frank Adu. The Grandassa models wore African traditional and African-inspired fashions and jewelry by black designers. Also featured in the show that evening were Abby Lincoln, accompanied by Max Roach. Yeah, it was really a show. The theme of the Naturally fashion shows, Black is Beautiful, was first promoted by Marcus Garvey in the 1920s. Unlike many of the fashion shows at the time, which featured black models with Eurocentric features, lighter skin tones, and straightened hair, the Grandassa models reflected the Afrocentric beauty of the black woman with kinky hair and darker complexions. Naturally 62 was an immediate success and was followed by other Naturally fashion shows in New York, Detroit, and Chicago. The shows were copied by other black fashion shows in the United States and Africa. During the 60s, the natural or Afro became the hairstyle for millions of black women and men. The Naturally fashion shows featuring the Grandassa models, African musical entertainment, along with actors Frank Adu, Leroy Satch Giles, Ernest Baxter, and David K. Ward, continued from 1962 to to 1979 with commemorative events on 10-year anniversaries through 2002. Today, by photographs by Kwame Brathwaite, published in newspapers, magazines, and displayed at exhibits around the country, show the beauty of the Grandassa models. Naturally 18 pays tribute to the Grandassa models, pioneers of the Black is Beautiful movement, which started 57 years ago. And the legacy of Alambe Brath.
Thank you all for coming out for our celebration and our acknowledgement of all the works that we have put in to pass the tradition on of our African beauty, our heritage, and all the things that our African women and men represent. My name is Nana Bakhine, Akukuram Ponyerenchua. People also know me as Mama Zamye or Sister Zamye, which I was blessed with that name from Baba Yolambe Brath. As an Akan priest, there's a lot of protocols that we follow, and one of our important protocols that we always follow in our African culture is to give homage to the Most High, to Mother Earth, to all the great powers of our life, and to our ancestors. So we're going to pour libation to give honor and to officially bless the occasion. So when I say Ago, the response is Ameh. And I will say a few words in Chi, T-W-I, and in English. Thank you. Ago.
Amen.
Ago.
Amen.
Ago.
Amen.
Oh, Chidimpon Kwame Bejinsa. Asasiya Bejinsa. Adarikofi Bejinsa. Nanesi Kitua Bejinsa. Bofugari Bejinsa. Abosumpim Bejinsa. Napim Supim Bejinsa. Nana Kofahini Aparibia Bejinsa. Nana Yao Parijinizu Bejinsa. Nana Kunodi Abena Bejinsa. With Awadama. Nana Numin Saman for Bejinsa. All of our great ancestors whose names we know and don't know, we ask that you accept this drink. Nana Ya Santua Bejinsa. Kwame Nkrumah Bejinsa. Malcolm X Bejinsa. Marcus Garvey Bejinsa. Carlos Cooks Bejinsa. Queen Mother Moore Bejinsa. Mama Keke Bejinsa. Any names that you want to call out, you're welcome to call out any names. Bobby Shangi, Joe Mensah. All the great ancestors, all of our beloved ancestors from our own lineages, the right and the left, we ask that you take this drink. We ask Baba Yolambe Brath, our father, Baba, we love you, and all of the pioneers who have gone on before us to pave the way, they are all watching over us. We ask that you accept this drink. Wadawadama, Nananum, Almighty God, all of the great powers, the deities, our ancestors, we are human and we cannot make water. But we use water because you have given it to us. Water is life. So we ask that you bless each and every one who's here with long life, peace, health, prosperity, success in all endeavors, healing of any problems, be they mental, physical, or spiritual. We ask that you bless us on this day to reignite and reinvigorate ourselves, that we are not lost people. That we are truly found people. And we are going back to our traditions and bringing them forward. Wadawadama, we ask that you bless this space and that more people will come out and utilize the Dwyer Cultural Center, AJAZ, the Yolambe Brath Foundation, the Grandassa Models, our very, very important musicians, Jelly, they tell the story.
Yeah.
We can't tell our story without them.
Yeah.
So we are just asking for your blessings today. Nana Shrejibi Pampa Sudria, Asu Yiri Pebre, Nana Shikitua Korobresi Amon Takra Boni Takra Doso. We ask that you accept this water on our behalf.
Yeah.
And everything that you have given to us, we give it back to you. And we ask that you give back to us.
Yeah.
Bless the children. Bless the elders.
Yeah.
Bless the family.
Yeah.
Bless the community.
Yeah.
Bless us in our righteous struggle that we will be victorious.
Yeah.
Wada wadama. Everyone say, yo.
Yo.
Say, medasi.
Medasi.
Yana no.
Yana no.
Yo.
Black women were in chains, as well as black men, a fact that we all know. But we'll see to it that it doesn't happen again. We'll build a nation of our own. Break the chains. I'd like you to drink. Break the chains. Men like Garvey came along, taught us about our glorious destiny. He taught us about the red, black, and green, and how to control our own destiny. Break the chains.
Break the chains.
A cub of Mr. Garvey, Carlos Cooks, came along, taught us the lessons that helped us to understand who we are. And now that we know who we are, there's no way that we would ever be subjected again. Break the chains. The chains have been lifted from off our minds. We now know who we are. We soar to unparalleled heights, and we now control our own destiny. Chains broken.
Wounded by white hatred. Who am I? I am the lioness, bit by the inhuman dogs of Southern racism and ignorance and fear. I am the descendant of survivors, as all of you are. I am the grandmother of determination. I am the mother of greatness. I am the daughter of love. And I am the child of Black Panther strength. So who am I? I am an African, black woman. And oh yeah, I'm a Grandassa model. Our lucha continua was the call of the day. The struggle continues was what we used to say. African Liberation Day, ALSC. Support the fight for freedom. Africa must be free. Boycott Portuguese products. Everyone do your part. The timeless beauty of the African woman is inspirational. It's more than art. Your image has invigorated us. It has inspired us as Black Madonna, the first mother, or soldier marching on the battlefield. You have done it all, stood proud, and pushed us forward. Ageless beauty is to be honored and revered. So here we are. Honor us and revere us. Ceiling so tight, the elephant has come. Giving praises to Sekou Touré, he put the colonizer on the run. Ceiling so tight, the elephant has come. Touré said revolution is above all an act of culture. Grandassa had to let him know. Colonialismo, abba. Neocolonialismo, abba. Imperialismo, abba. Abba. Abolish oppression. Abolish oppression. From Guinea-Bissau to Sao Tome to all over the motherland. Abolish oppression in Angola and Mozambique, Zimbabwe and South Africa. Our homeland must be free. Lumumba, Lumumba hatuwezi kufa. Lumumba, Lumumba hatuwezi kufa. Lumumba is not dead. He lives on inside of us. Lumumba, Lumumba hatuwezi kufa. No, Lumumba is not dead. His scattered remains are reconnected in each of us. Lumumba, Lumumba hatuwezi kufa. I am Lumumba. You are Lumumba. We are Lumumba. Yebedikunyim, yebedikunyim. Yebedikunyim, yebedikunyim. Ebebima, ebebima go say. Joe Mensa taught us songs to praise our people. Kwame Nkrumah said, Africa must unite. Grandassa's chanted, we will win, we will win. There is no unity for Africa without the black man, woman, and child. Nanaya Asantewaa rallied everyone to fight. And we are Ya Asantewaa. We will never take flight. A luta continua was the call of the day. Pamoja tutashinda is what we used to say. The struggle continues, and we will never let it go. And we will go on, we will win. We will not bow our heads in shame. We stand proud, heads held high, because we carry the Grandassa name. We stand for beauty, grace, courage, and faith. We are passing on the mantle for future generations to embrace. Bless you, Baba. Bless us all. I say.
I remember when I looked in the mirror and decided that I wasn't going to straighten my hair. I remember when I went in and looked in the mirror and decided I wasn't going to straighten my hair anymore. I was going to wear my hair natural, leave it as it was. So I cut my hair and wore it as it was. And then people said, why do you wear your hair as it like that? And I said, because it's beautiful, and I like it like that. I remember Bob Marley. And I remember my dear friend, Abby Lincoln, who was such a wonderful woman. And my husband, Lambe Brath, and my oldest son, Garvey Lambe. And my second son, Ramses, and my third son, Sinke. My fourth son, Chagun. My fifth son, Sekun. And my sixth son, Mandela. They're all beautiful men, beautiful black men. And I have three grandchildren. I have four grandchildren. My oldest grandchild's name is Miles Ilambe. And I have a granddaughter, Ramaya Itelka Brathwaite. And I have two grandsons, Asani Amiri, and Messiah Day. I've been blessed with all of these grandchildren and the love of a wonderful husband. And I love working with all the Grandassa models. They were all my friends for many years. I love the struggles that we've been through together. All the marches on 125th Street, to close down the beauty parlors, the workshops, which we did. We closed down those workshops on 125th Street. And I remember Patrice Lumumba, Alusua Continua, Patrice Lumumba. Patrice Lumumba still lives. Even though he was murdered in the most horrible way, he's still alive in all of us.
That's right.
Yes, sir. And I remember Sekou Touré too, because Sekou Touré was a wonderful man. And one of my sons is named after him. And I remember this day, because this is a wonderful day, where all of the Grandassas have come together in this year of 2018 to celebrate our 50th anniversary. Yes. Thank you very much. I love you all.
Wow, this has been an awesome journey. When Adamola, who over 5 years would say, Sekolo, why didn't you do a Grandassa reunion? Sekolo, why didn't you do a Grandassa reunion? Finally in December, I said, you know what, let's do it. And in December, we started, I called, and the response was amazing. Just like when we were Grandassas, there wasn't an individual superstar. We were sisters. It was communal. Very much supportive. In fact, I learned how to sew because I would wear outfits that were European made and they were designer names. And my first meeting, I thought, oh, I have on this designer outfit. And when I got there, they were complimenting. Numso was one of the people who designed. They would compliment each other, and nobody said my outfit was nice. So, and the idea was, you didn't make it. You didn't create it. The things that you create are the things that we are complimenting and affirming. So I learned how to sew because of the fact that I wanted to be a Grandassa model, and I also wanted to be complimented on my creativity. So at this time, I'd like to call the beautiful women who we worked for the last 9 months to pull this together. I'd like you all come up on the stage with me so that we... This time also, we would like to acknowledge, if you notice in the program, there are so many acknowledgments. It's like at the end of a film, all the people that you thank. And truly, we had so much support. The Dwyer Cultural Center, the Alambe Beth Foundation, the graphic artists. They're all named in the program. We got to thank everybody, and we really appreciate Harold, who's been coaching us. Daoud, with this amazing cuisine that you all will partake of. Minerva, who is like a one-man army in terms of organizing the Dwyer. The drummers, who really just made this an amazing journey. Didn't do the choral. Okay, so there is one piece, because we had an open program, there is still one piece that Black Rose would like to do, and we'll do it while we're all up here. Okay.
We Grandassa models have a 57-year legacy of advocating and representing our African ancestral standard of beauty. Everybody say, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Sounds good. Unity, we agree. Yes, defending with pride our ancestral legacy of being the first beauty on the planet.
Yeah.
Ashe, ashe. We have to cherish and value our unique blessings, our beautiful African beauty. The fact is, no other groups of people in the universe are blessed with our beautiful, woolly, curly African hair. Combined with our sun-kissed caramel to ebony black melanated skin, including curvaceous physiognomy. Ashe, ashe! Ashe, ashe! Ashe, ashe! Everybody say, yeah, yeah! Our future generations will be motivated by this awareness to pass the baton of our cultural heritage forward, never to vanish. Know thyself better than those who speak of thee. everybody say, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Ashe, ashe. Ashe, ashe,
this historic night. Before we close, we'd like to have you hear some closing remarks from several of the important people who played a role in AJAZZ. The first individual will be Cinque Brathwaite, the son of Alambe.
How many, raise your hand if you know who Sonny Carson is. So I came across Sonny Carson, who is the father of Lumumba Carson of the rap group The X-Clan. And he was talking about the beauty of the Grandassa models. And there was a video from, I think it was my father's 65th birthday. It was the Harlem State Office Building. They asked Sonny to say a few words. And he sort of went into how he wanted to thank Yolambe so much for, you know, introducing him to a Grandassa model. There was a room full of people. He's like, don't hate. He said, but the Grandassa models were the epitome of elegance and beauty. He said, I know it's a lot of women here, but he felt like coming out of Brooklyn in his rough background, that if you didn't have a Grandassa model, you wasn't doing nothing. He said, the woman was on him at that. He said, I'm just sorry. That's how I have to tell it, because that was his experience. So, you know, when you come across these things, like, wow, you did not realize that who we call a Boobadika, Sonny Carson, wife was, and the mother of the rap group X-Clan was a Grandassa model. You know, in fact, there's a clip of this talking by Sonny Carson. If you go on, right now, on the Instagram account, some of you might be like, Instagram? We don't got no Instagram. But some of you might have Instagram. It's one of the newer technology that some of that younger generation use. And you go on the Yolambe Brath Foundation account, you will see Sonny Carson talking about how the Grandassa models were the standard for everything that he thought, and how being married to a Grandassa model changed his life. And I thought it was I just came across it. It was so beautiful. We had somebody put that video up. If you go to Yolambe Brath Foundation on Instagram, you will get to see. It's like a one-minute clip. It's amazing. But everything about Grandassa models is not so amazing, or it's kind of mixed. During this same time, I got to tell a story about another person famous in our history and our culture. His name is Eldridge Cleaver. Everybody know Eldridge Cleaver, minister of the Black Panthers. He has a history with the Grandassa models also. So let's go a brief story. So recently, Robert Gums and Cyril Innes had his wife over at the Schomburg for an exhibit. And they were looking at the Black Power 50 exhibit. And Eldridge Cleaver was saying, his wife Kathleen was looking at, you know, some of the same images we see here over at the Schomburg. In fact, I was asked to remind people here that they need to go see the Black Power 50 exhibit. And you can see AJAZZ, you can see Grandassa at the Schomburg. But if you remember, Eldridge Cleaver came out with a book called Soul on Ice. And in that book, Soul on Ice, Eldridge Cleaver said some of the most unforgivable things about our sisters. He wrote this book when he was in Soledad Penitentiary. And we're not even going to repeat the things that Eldridge said about Black women. It was not nice. It was not beautiful. It was not something that we want to highlight. However, if you get that book, or if you've read that book, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Interestingly enough, however, this same Eldridge Cleaver had written the letter after he was in prison and he saw the Grandassa models for the first time in his life. Now, he wrote the letter into the AJAZZ headquarters on 125th Street, and he was flabbergasted. He was floored about the beauty of these women. He had never seen anything like this in his life, and he was saying so in the letter. He particularly was infatuated with one of the models who's no longer with us. Her name was Jean Gumbs. Actually, she's Robert Gumbs' sister. Robert Gumbs is the vice president of Lambe Braff Foundation. She was a Grandassa model who's passed on. But he was writing in this letter like he couldn't wait to get out of prison. He was so blown away with the Grandassa models. He'd never seen anything like it in his life. And he was writing in about the Grandassa models from Folsom, okay? This is when he was in prison, but this shows you the reach of the Grandassa models, not just in New York and Pennsylvania and places like that, but globally. You know, some of the earlier presentations you saw, you might have saw the Grandassa models who graced the covers of international magazines across the globe, okay? That sort of impact, you saw them on African Parade magazine in Zimbabwe, you know, where they were talking about what the Grandassa models was doing here in the United States. And they were reflecting on that, and they were wanting the women in Zimbabwe to look what the sisters in United States are doing. Look what they're doing with their hair. We want to, you know, because truth be told, our brothers and sisters in the diaspora, a lot of times they were looking, especially at that time, they were looking here for inspiration. And so that same inspiration they were looking for, they were seeing, not just politically, but also in the Grandassa models. And whether it's Cheney University in Pennsylvania, which had exhibits with the Grandassa models, but they were also using exhibits that were showing what countries were pulling outside of the United States, were pulling off the images of the Grandassa models. So I say that to mention just two of the areas. We got Sonny Carson in Love. We got Eldridge Cleaver initially in Love, but then came back later and wrote Soul on Ice. But when he first saw the Grandassas, was blown away. I mean, wrote the letter into Grandassa's headquarters on 125th Street. Oh my God, he was blown away by the Grandassa models. We don't know what happened to him while he was in that prison from Folsom or whatever. He changed it up a little bit, but he wrote in and he was in awe of the beauty and the style of this woman. Another person who was in awe and beauty and style of the Grandassa woman, what people really don't know about, is the one and only Godfather of Soul, James Brown. Yes, James Brown. So as many of you know, James Brown, who wrote, "Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud." Now, we can't pinpoint exactly where his inspiration came. Well, he co-wrote that with another brother who happened to work with Lou Donaldson. Now, of course, you all saw the album covers. Lou Donaldson had the Grandassas all day, and Lou Donaldson also had Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud a few months after James Brown. But James Brown, as my father would always tell the story, if you know where the AJAZZ headquarters is and you know where the Apollo Theater is, James Brown came into the mainstream in 1963. Grandassa models debuted in 62. James Brown, the hardest working man in America, was always back and forth to Harlem trying to keep his eye on his money. It was at the Apollo. So he was back and forth. James Brown happened upon the Grandassa models, and he was blown away. As my father tells the story, when he first saw them, that opening, that, what do we call it, that preamble for that song, that's when my father first heard it. James Brown said, "Good God." When he saw the Grandassa models. Good. And he touched his hair. He touched his hair. He said he'd never seen anything like it. He had his handlers with him. Of course, the Apollo and the officers of AJAZZ are basically right back, right next to one another. James Brown was blown away in his first time coming across the Grandassa models. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, we don't know how we want to place the influence, but he's seen our sisters. Exactly. I love Lou Donaldson. Lou Donaldson is what we call the Aggie. I went to North Carolina A&T. That's where Lou Donaldson is from. He's a great musician. The brother with James Brown played with Lou Donaldson. And that jazz world, they all connected. So we know, we don't totally pinpoint it, but James Brown when he was talking about say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud, he was talking about the Grandassa models. That good God, that's the first time he ever said it or they ever heard it. That's what he said before his handlers carried him off. So I just want to leave you all with those impressions, James Brown, Sonny Carson, Eldridge. Oh, man, wait a minute. I almost forgot. Joe Slim would kill me if I didn't mention this last part. But you know what? My phone is acting up. I wanted to tell about this influence with the Grandassa models all really started with the convention to abrogate the term Negro in 1959. That's where a lot of the inspiration for this came from. We can talk about style. We can talk about fashion. I mean, my grandfather, when he came from Barbados, he was a tailor. He knew about style. He knew about fashion. He was into clothes. He wanted my father to be a tailor like him. You know, he had nice clients. He had Bumpy Johnson, whoever. Those were all his clients. He wanted my father to go into that. My father and my Uncle Kwame, they was like, they were not going to go into that area. They had different ambitions. So basically they were not going to do that. But this whole initial part with them still playing a role in fashion and art, you know, along with their colleagues, Chris S. Mendici Hall, and I'm missing one other person, but he's been covered tonight also. This is what, you know, their artistry as a group of artists, African Jazz Art Society Studio, this is what they were doing. This area right on 125th Street is legendary because those offices that they had there where they were creating, they were doing photography, graphic arts, etc., was full of all sorts of legendary wisdom that has propelled us from now and will propel us for a few more generations. So without further ado, I would like to bring up the son. His name is Ace Antonio Hall. He is the son of Chris Asmendice Hall, one of the co-founders of the A-Jazz organization. And I'd like to bring him up to say a few words.
Hey, let's give a hand to the Grandassa models. 57 years later? Beautiful. One of the best things about, you know, me getting in my 50s, I'm 52, is that my emotions just start running real deep. And when I see something beautiful, it just touches me. And to see those models, I mean, you know, dancing on the line and coming all the way in, it just was beautiful. And to know that the Grandassa models, one of the things about all of our parents, our fathers, they instilled in us very, very early, at an early age, what beauty was and what black is beautiful really meant and what it meant to me. And I want to start off by saying, you know, I may be Chris Asmandisi Hall's son. My name is Asmandisi Nzondi Hall. Before I was Chris Asmandisi Hall, or before I was what I'm doing now, a novelist, and I'm working in L.A. in TV. I work on a show called How to Get Away with Murder. And I'm also, and I got to tell a really quick story in a minute about how I got back, or how I got involved with Sinke and Bob Gums. It's a beautiful story. Before all of that, I was my mother. Before I was my mother, I was my grandmother. Follow me. Before I was my grandmother, I was my great-great-grandmother, and so on. Before that, I was Mother Africa. Before I was Mother Africa, I was Mother Nature. And each one of them, each one of those entities are tied to me. There's an old ancient, I guess you can call it a meditation or a game or exercise would be a better word, that I do. I'm a keynote. I've done quite a couple of keynote speaking events for writing conferences this year. Have another one coming up in October. And I always start with this exercise. And I want everyone to do this exercise. The first thing I'm going to ask you is, what I'm going to ask you to say, I don't want you to say it out loud. I want you to say it in your mind. On the count of three, whatever you do, don't say this word out loud. Say it in your mind. You got that? Everyone has that? Don't say it out loud. Say it in your mind. The word I want you to say is power. Don't say it out loud. On the count of three, P-O-W-E-R, I want you to say power in your mind. I've heard KRS-One do this, and I've heard a lot of people who do meditation and do exercises, but this is not like a spiritual thing, so to speak. This is a point that I want to make, how I became my mother, my grandmother, my great-grandmother, my great-great-grandmother, Mother Earth, Mother Africa, Mother Nature. On the count of three, I want you to say power in your mind. Do not say it out loud. Notice how I say that over and over. You know I taught 13 years. I'm just regurgitating the same thing, repetitive. One, we're going to say power. Don't say it out loud. Don't say it out loud. In your mind. On the count of three, say power in your mind. One, two, three. So my question is, if you said power in your mind, my question is, whose voice was that? You just said power in your mind without moving any of this at all, without moving your mouth. And you heard yourself say power in your mind. Did you not? Did you, whoever said that, whoever went through that exercise, did you hear power in your mind? You actually heard yourself say power without moving your lips at all. What voice is that? Don't give it away. There is this common connection that we have. And if we use this connection, this power, we become empowered. Because we are not only in touch with that voice that spoke without even us saying a word, and we hear it. It's a voice that can go back in time. You can think something and say something in your mind and be right there when you were 8 years old and you fell off your bicycle and scratched your knee and your mom kissed your boo-boo, or whatever the memory is. The first time you went to the school dance and met your sweetheart, was kind of scared. I just saw a movie the other night. I went to this cultural thing and we analyzed the movie The Wood. If you remember that movie, when they were young, he was kind of scared to hug his girl. He kind of, you know, that first memory. You just went back in your mind. You can go back in time. What voice is that? That is the voice that when you feel injustice, you can call upon our who? Our ancestors. Our who? Our ancestors. We are connected. We are tied. We are one. We are unified. It is solidarity. When you feel that injustice, you call on that voice, and you become empowered. You can be angry, but still empowered, and call on that voice, and that voice gives you the strength. One more exercise. When I ask you to do this, I want you to do it as tight as you can. For those who can, do it as tight as you can. You might not be able to do it tight as you can, but for those who can, hold your fists up. And when I say squeeze tighter, as tight as you possibly can, and keep squeezing. Ready? Squeeze tight. Now squeeze tighter. Now squeeze tighter. There's always one in the crowd that says they didn't do it, but for everyone who did that, did you squeeze tighter every time? Because we can give. Even when we gave out as much as we possibly could, we can give more and give more. I believe that's tied to that power that empowered us. And here's the funny story. So my father, if you aren't familiar with his work, And it's funny, I appreciate it now. At 52, when I was 10 years old, I'm like, Dad, how come you always sing So What when it comes on? You know. Because he wrote it. Miles Davis walked off the stage, So What, he wrote that. And Bitches Brew and Chameleon. He penned the words to those songs, those jazz classics. And when I saw the Budweiser series, The Kings of Egypt, or the African Kings, sorry, Budweiser series, Dad did the Hannibal and a couple of other of those illustrations. And if you go to some bookstores or you go to some people's homes and you see the little Melanin and Me book Dad illustrated, or Let's Celebrate Kwanzaa, or, you know, those things. But there was someone who had, I don't even know if we had become Instagram friends, but he kept trying to reach out to me, and I didn't know who he was. I'm like, who is this Sinke guy? Who is this guy? Who is this guy? And finally, I found out who Sinke was, and he said, Bob Gums has been trying to reach you. I'm like, I remember Bob Gums. That was one of my dad's first publishers. Yeah. So I had no way of reaching Bob Gum. I looked it up on the internet and I found his phone number. The joy of internet, the beauty of it. And I called him. And you know what he said? He said, Ossie, he calls me Ossie. I love that. Because it's Ossie Mandisi. He calls me Ossie. A-C-E, Ossie Mandisi. He said, Ossie, I just had my phone in my hand and I was thinking, how could I reach you? Everyone in your mind say power. In your mind, don't say that loud. In your mind, power. There is a connection. If we can just tap into it, it is so strong. Before I was Asaman DC, I was my mother. Before I was my mother, and so on. There's this strength. And now I am so glad that I was able to come to New York and to be a part of the celebration. To see the Grandassa Models. I didn't know Ann Tripp was a Grandassa Model. I used to listen to Ann Tripp when I was in New York all the time. I'm like, Ann Tripp is a Grandassa Model? You know, but I've always known, like Nana Bakan, you know, I've known her for a long time. I see her children now and they're bigger than me. I remember when they were in diapers. They're taller than I am, you know? And she was one of the Grandassa Models, and it's just so wonderful, and it is so beautiful to see that the legacy is continuing, and we have to continue the legacy. You know why? Because we are the guardians of perception. What do I mean by we're the guardians of perception? Is Dr. Jeffries still in here? I can't see with the lights. Dr. Jeffries, are you in here? All right, Dr. Jeffries. So, well, I taught for 13 years in New York, Hempstead, New York, and in Queens, Springfield Gardens, 231. Before I was certified as a teacher, I started out as a substitute teacher, and then I was a teacher's aide, and then permanent sub, and then certified, and I taught English. Well, before that, in Hempstead, they were like, oh, you could teach? They just threw me in the classroom. Well, teach history. I'm like, I hate history. My dad is always talking about history. I hated it. So I took it upon myself to teach history. So we had two books. We had a book about Egypt, which I loved, and then we had the regular history book. And in the regular history book, which was about yay long, you know, yay thick, you've seen the books, you know, we've all had different types. They had a little tiny, tiny, small section, little tiny section that involved my people. And that section was always about slavery. I mean, that's cool, you know. Yeah, it's cool that Harriet Tubman and